subscribing, and leaving comments.
Stories of an elusive creature.
I've twice heard the sound, the call, as the Sherpas have confirmed, of what they said was the Yeti. One at very close range indeed.
The Yeti. The abominable snowman, is it just a legend, or does it really live in these remote valleys?
We know that these hunting mammals live here, but they're very, very rarely seen.
It was bigger than a man in my vision, but I was on a distance of 10 meters. So it was my impression, it's bigger than me. It was quite hairy and strong.
A journey into one of the world's great mysteries, the search for the Yeti.
Adventure is made possible by this station and other public television stations nationwide, and by a grant from BASF. In one industry after another, from aerospace to biotechnology, we're creating new worlds by seeing in new ways. BASF, the spirit of innovation.
Twice heard the sound, the call, as the Sherpas have confirmed, of what they said was the Yeti. One at very close range indeed.
Quite a lot of the older Sherpas who believe that the Yeti makes a sort of a rather strange whistling sort of noise. And they will actually tell you of occasions when they were in a high mountain hut and it was snowing outside and they had the yaks in the hut too. And then they heard this whistling noise outside, and they immediately knew there was a Yeti walking around about the hut.
For 60 years, explorers have been trying to find conclusive proof of the Yeti, or abominable snowman. Yeti hunters have concentrated their search on the Nepalese Himalayas, but mountaineer Chris Bonington has now persuaded the Chinese government to invite our expedition of climbers, experts, and journalists to explore one of the remotest parts of Tibet.
Oh, this is lovely, isn't it?
Well, this is entirely...
I first went to the Himalayas 28 years ago, and in all the subsequent visits, I've heard stories about the Yeti, and it's always fascinated me to wonder just whether it does exist. Last year, we saw these intriguing tracks that definitely looked like some kind of two-legged creature. This is what really focused my attention on the Yeti.
Well, we eat a yak a day.
The three-month-long trek into Tibet begins in Kathmandu, the expedition capital of the world. We'll need 3 tons of food and over 2 tons of gear, plus 100 yaks to carry it all.
You have there's a bigger selection of tobacco.
Is there?
Yeah.
This would be good. Sorry, just a job.
How much are these? This is not for water.
Yeah, it's pea bottle.
Pea bottle. So it's okay.
Is this big enough for you?
Yep.
Amidst the temples and markets of Kathmandu, we get our first scent of the Yeti. Sherpas, Nepalese, Tibetan refugees all have a story to tell.
We're going off to try to find the Yeti. Do you believe in a Yeti?
Yeah, we believe there's a Yeti, but I've not seen.
Not yourself?
Not myself. Mm. Just I've seen the picture of the Yeti, is not.
Oh, they're painting.
Yeah, painting.
And what do they look like?
Looks like big monkey.
The Yeti has become a potent symbol of the mountains, a monster that is easily merchandised. Real or imaginary, he's given a name in every culture of the Himalayas and beyond. Yeti, Chuti, Tamu, Wild Man, the Abominable Snowman. For some, there's no doubt that the Yeti exists, palpable flesh and blood.
We are coming a group, you know, by horse. We got some light machine guns. And the young Tamu is coming, and we shoot it down. And we use the skin we brought into India.
How big was this Yeti, what you call the Tamu?
That's small size one. It's like about 5 feet man size, you know. Some Tamus are bigger. That man killed, that's a very big one. It's gonna be about 7-8 feet.
And what did it look like?
Look like man.
In the Himalayas, sightings and stories of the Yeti suggest its habitat ranges from western Nepal through Tibet and into eastern Bhutan.
When we're young, we're coached on certain ways how to approach or how to tackle what you may encounter. Like, for example, if you encounter a bear, you are supposed to lie flat on the ground, pretend dead. And we are told that, well, the bear will come and sniff around and go away. And then on the Yetis, we are told that male Yetis have very high forehead. So if you are chased by a male Yeti, you run up the hill, see? And the male Yeti looks up where you are and then again starts chasing you. And then again he looks up, by the time you gain pace on him. Now, female Yetis are supposed to have very long breast. And the breast is supposed to, they are supposed, while they are walking, they put on their shoulders, so when the female Yeti chase you, you are supposed to run downhill because the breast will start, keep on falling down, and the female Yeti has to stop and put it on your shoulder, and then you get away.
My grandmother's friend went into the wood, you know, to collect some bamboos for their roofing, and she got lost in the middle of the forest. She met with a Yeti, and the Yeti took her to a cave where he used to live. And she was fed with raw meat for about 5 months.
Everywhere there is a Yeti. Most of them, they are staying in this wild area, you know. This doesn't want to disturb by any human beings.
Our search for the Yeti will take us across Nepal, into Tibet, and on to Menlung Tse, one of the great unclimbed Himalayan peaks. Chris Bonington hopes to make the first ascent. Leaving behind the populated Kathmandu Valley, we head northwards, passing through the Sherpa villages that line the Kathmandu Lhasa Road.
Hey,
The friendship bridge that separates Nepal from Tibet is none too friendly. Relations between the Chinese government and the Tibetans are tense.
34942.
Our visas have been refused. We wait patiently. The prospect, a night in no man's land. Morning brings good news. We're to be allowed to continue. At the top of the hill, a truck is waiting. It will take us up to the Tibetan plateau, past Tingri, the last outpost before Everest, and onto the base of the Fushi La Pass.
Extra day.
At 14,000 feet, the road runs out. But 30 local yak herders have promised to take us on the next leg, over the Fushi La Pass and into the Rongsha Gorge. We await their arrival and our first contact with the yaks. Without them, we're stranded. The yak herders are soon busy trying to persuade their yaks to carry our unusual and awkward loads. Each of the 97 yaks will have to carry 50 kilos of gear and provisions. We will travel as lightly as possible. Altitude sickness is beginning to affect us. Headache, nausea, dehydration are common symptoms. But there's a great sense of excitement. We're only the fourth group of Westerners in history to make this journey.
Thank you.
In the Rongsha Gorge, the river, swollen with melting snow, teems with food for the dippers and redstarts. After 3 days of high-altitude walking, there's the welcome sight of a village, Changbuje, and a chance to rest our tired limbs. Changbuje is for us a staging post where we'll hire fresh yaks for the journey on to Melungtse. We pay off our yak herders and set up camp for a few days acclimatization. Before they return over the Fushi La Pass, a treat is prepared for the yaks. Domesticated yaks are highly strung animals, but they're usually more cooperative after a meal of the rissoles made with barley flour and tea leaves. Dawn at Changbuje, and life seems unaffected by our invasion.
Good, yes. Good, well done. Great, great.
Shit. Okay, this is where I start running into problems.
It's not a lot outright.
Leaves.
Oh.
Chris goes off to look for an old Tibetan climbing friend, Kusang, who he hopes will guide us to Melungtse and help us search for the Yeti. Dr. Charlie Clark, our medical and scientific officer, soon has a full surgery in the mess tent.
Does it hurt when I do this?
No.
It doesn't hurt when I do that, does it?
Oh, yeah.
He doesn't seem in pain when I do that.
You think so?
Anyway, take those antibiotics, and I'll see him when we come back.
等我们先等，先吃点药。等我们不，等回来实在不好，等我们回来再去再看一下。
Gosh, is that a snow leopard?
So when was this shot?
No, he's a very old.
It was a very old leopard.
Yeah.
What animals might we see?
We can see a leopard, and we call na, just like a sheep, more bigger than a sheep.
The Tibetan sheep. Yeah.
More bigger than a sheep. Mm-hmm. The horn. Horn also so big.
No intermediate movers. All right, let's move.
Well done.
All right, yeah, I'll give you
Have you heard any stories from the old man about yetis?
About three or four, 5 years ago. Sometimes I heard. But actually, yeti are not just like our monkey, much bigger than a monkey. That monkey is not so long hair, but just like a monkey. We are very
big. How big?
It's very, very big.
Bigger than a man.
Bigger than man. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he goes like that, just like a monkey or animal.
But he goes on all fours.
All foot. Sometimes he's going just like an old man, stay there.
And was this was seen 3-5 years ago?
Yeah, 3-5 years ago.
Bear is a really complete animal. And Tamil is looks like man, you know, and figure everything same as man. But most time he go with two hands and two legs. And when he rest, he stand like man.
Reinhold Messner, probably the greatest mountaineer of all time, doubted the Yeti's existence until a recent encounter.
I was walking for a long time in eastern Tibet, and it was not night, it was getting evening, at 4 o'clock in the evening, calculating our timetable would be at 6-7 o'clock in the evening. I came through a high wood place, 4,200 meters, it's about 14,000 feet, and there maybe a Yeti was sleeping or something like that, and he got up. He stand up on two legs and he ran away on four legs. And seeing the footprints and seeing the figure, I immediately was thinking this exactly the animal matching the legend figure I had in my mind from all these discussions and these sayings in the base camps and in the Sherpa houses when I was on expedition.
Refreshed and acclimatized, it's time to move on. Our new yaks and their owners gather to load up.
23 yak herders, or 25?
Yeah.
23 or 25?
I think, how much they will make?
3 or 5?
20, maybe.
There are long and heated discussions over pay and conditions. Every Tibetan village has its own Communist Party officials. But here in Changbuje, they turn a blind eye to this kind of free enterprise.
Some are heavy and some are light.
Light, yeah.
But they can put on their yaks some heavy load and some light load.
Yeah.
To make it balance, yeah?
Yeah.
These are tough negotiations for our logistics manager, Jess Stock.
Dealing with the yak drivers has been a great challenge for me as a past businessman, and negotiating with them for our objective of getting to base camp. They have got you over a barrel in their negotiations. It's a union that you could never break. They are absolutely a law unto themselves. I mean, they're really friendly, happy people, and then they just shaft you.
The negotiations completed, our new yak train crosses the Rongsha River. At the entrance to the Menlung Valley, prayer flags are offered for a safe trek to base camp. We are now 4 weeks into our journey and entering ideal Yeti territory.
Eric Shipton, of course, saw tracks of the Yeti right at the head of the Menlung Valley, actually up above the snow line. But that can't be where the Yeti lives. That's where I suspect the Yeti either hunts, or maybe the Yeti travels from one valley to the next. The young Tibetan told us that he met three people who'd actually seen a small family of Yeti, four Yetis in the forest.
I should imagine this kind of area is the place where you would get the Yeti. And I think just looking around here, you can imagine as well why nobody's actually managed to find one. I mean, once you're off the path, it is so incredibly dense and difficult to cover the terrain. There's these kind of rocky cliffs, there must be caves tucked away inside there. And it'd take you years, I should imagine, to really cover all that terrain. And I should imagine the Yeti has a very, very good sense of hearing. If he hasn't got some kind of extrasensory perception almost, which is one thing that has been ascribed to the Yeti, so you'd have absolutely no trouble whatsoever in getting out of your way, way before you could ever get anywhere close to him.
We enter a dwarf rhododendron forest. With 75 yaks ahead of us, it's hardly surprising that we don't see any wildlife. We plan to return here without them for a proper search. And then, from the forest, our first view of Menlungtse. For Chris and the rest of the climbing team, it's a reminder that they face one of the hardest climbs in the world. From now on, their thoughts will be primarily on making the first ascent of the mountain. The rest of us will concentrate on looking for the Yeti. We snake our way to the head of the valley, past the towering massif of Gaurishankar that marks the border with Nepal. At 15,000 feet, under the western ridge of Menlungtse, we establish base camp. The yaks unloaded, the yak herders are paid off. We'll be on our own from now. Kusang organizes a puja, a Buddhist prayer ceremony. He asks for success and safety in our twin goals of finding the Yeti and climbing the mountain.
And are you? Climbing the photo, everything.
Looking at my three climbing partners, I'd find it, you know, as every time, I mean, terribly hard to take. If anything happened, and I just pray, I mean, in that puja this morning, it's something I feel very intense about, and I've just prayed that all of us would come back alive. And you can't go on climbing over a large number of years without realizing, without understanding the risks and the dangers, so that I don't do it lightly. And yet at the same time, I love the climbing so much, and it's so much fun, that most of the time, one pushes that awareness, if you like, underneath. And it's only when you're actually, when someone like you probes it out, that it's very much there.
Settling into base camp gives us the opportunity to observe the wildlife. The Himalayan tar, blue sheep, and ibex are daily visitors to nearby slopes. All good quarry for any large predator, a bear, a snow leopard, or even a yeti. The potential yeti habitat is explored by Dr. Charlie Clark.
The amount of surface area here is absolutely enormous. I mean, there are high yak pastures and presumably unvisited pastures that cover many, many square miles. And of course, it's very, very rich country. There's quite enough to eat here. I mean, there are marmots, there are Himalayan shrews and mice. It can eat roots, juniper berries. We're just above the bamboo forests. Certainly from the character and the hair and the debris and the fecal matter, it's quite clear that there are carnivores around. One's either got to say that they're cats, bears or snow leopards. And that's what they look like. We know that these hunting mammals live here, but they're very, very rarely seen, either by local inhabitants or by ourselves.
For seeing them, for a Westerner, it's quite impossible because we don't know when he's moving, how he's moving, where exactly he's going, and he is very intelligent. A deer is quite difficult to follow, but the Yeti is 10 times more intelligent, this I'm sure. And so, Tibet is big, the Himalayas are huge. It's not like going in Britain in a small valley to look for a deer. There you can wait for 1 week, for 1 month also to get a picture of. But Tibet is huge.
Back in the rhododendron forest, photographer David O'Neill is preparing a high-tech surprise for the Yeti.
I've invested a lot of time in getting this electronic device together, which will enable me, hopefully, if the Yeti comes my way, to take a photograph of it. Sophisticated little box. Basically, you switch it all on, and when the Yeti, hopefully, hits the cotton, the camera goes off and the flash at the same time. So, bang, you've got it. I'm optimistic I'll get something with it because it's a very good device, it works. I caught many people on Hampstead Heath with it. The Yeti, well, I'm still trying.
We've heard stories that the Yeti comes to the snow line to feed on saline moss. Charlie Clark sets up our own salt lick to tempt him. For Chris and his climbing team, the priority now is to find a route to the summit.
Well, but it'd be better to start from there than from this promontory. That would give us, that would guarantee us getting through that in a day.
There's certainly no easy way up Mount Nungse. I think it's one of the hardest mountains that I've ever come across. And this seems to be the easiest way up. And it looks very, very difficult. It must be a good 2,000 meters to the summit, and we'll be picking our way up this incredibly long, complex ridge over rock and a
a lot of snow and ice. It'll be very, very difficult to get back down if the weather breaks. And then right up there at the top, we've got this rocky headwall that's certainly going to provide a really nasty sting in the tail. It's going to be difficult climbing that and actually getting to the summit.
I am a tiny bit worried. Here I am, 53 years of age. And it's the worry, really, that am I going to keep the others back? Am I going to slow them down? If we manage to climb it, I think we've got a good chance. It'll be a quite extraordinarily satisfying thing. I mean, it's on the same level as Everest.
The night before a big climb, I always feel a mixture of excitement and yet at the same time also of some fear. And there's a definite tightening in one's belly. I certainly am not going to sleep very well tonight either.
Chris isn't the only one who's going to be nervous tonight. As the high altitude cameraman on this climb, I'll probably lay awake a few extra hours, making sure I haven't forgotten anything that I need for filming. The time morning comes, it's usually a combination of relief and excitement to finally be on the way and have the chance to come to grips with the challenge of the mountain. The single most exciting aspect of climbing a mountain like Minlunce is that it's a mountain no one has ever climbed before, and there's no known route to the summit. I suspect on this climb, the first 3,000 or 4,000 feet are going to be steep snow and ice gullies, some rock. And an interesting feature of this climb is that the higher we go, the harder it gets. And I suspect there's going to be some really tough climbing near the summit. High on the mountain, it wouldn't surprise me at all if we encounter some sort of difficulties, either weather or hard technical difficulties, which force us back down.
On a scouting trip, Dr. Clark and Kusang discover a cave. Could this be a bear's den or even a Yeti's lair?
It does seem extraordinary that there's not evidence of hair, of skulls, of bones, of caves, of Yeti dens, or if it were a tool using animal of some form of tool. And that does surprise me.
How big? Yes. But yeah. I mean, there don't seem to be any animals would be up here, do they? Do you see the tree back there that was cut? Those flat stones where, I don't know, a sadhu may have spent some time up there. There's some pips there, aren't there, and some bird droppings. But once again, it's not the place where he lived, is it?
Yeah.
Thank you. Back at the cave, we mount a night watch. Image intensifiers, which magnify the available light 60,000 times, give us good visibility in the moonlight. Some think the Yeti is nocturnal. Our Sherpas tell us they've been known to attack yaks at night. Our salt lick remains untouched. Morning after an overnight snowfall. Any animal tracks should be clearly visible in the soft snow. Expedition members explore in different directions.
I gave myself quite a shock because I was up skiing at about 18,500 feet, went up to one of the ridges behind base camp, and just as I came up to the ridge, I saw some footprints that looked remarkably like human footprints, and I thought, I'm sure nobody's been up here. In fact, I know nobody's been up here. I'm probably the first person in history to be in that place. What are these footprints doing?
High on a distant slope, more fresh tracks are discovered. We're excited. They look unusual. We take Kusang up the ridge to help interpret them.
What do you think they are, Kusang?
I think that one, the big horn. Not is that.
Well, like the ibex.
Yeah. Maybe the smaller Yeti.
Chuti.
Yeah.
Could be Chuti. I mean, because they're very small
very
spaces.
Very small. Yeah. If the Yeti is the so long, so far that we goes.
Because it's in a very straight line.
Straight line.
What about snow leopard? Sick.
No.
Because that would make
very small.
Small pug.
Because
I mean, if you
look about this, little bigger than the dog.
Yeah.
Much smaller than this.
Yeah, it's a big print.
It's a big, very big print.
We've seen ibex and blue sheep footprints, and then there are, of course, the much wider, less distinct footprints that we've seen in the snow that have been about, you know, sort of 8 inches across or something like that, but poorly formed. We haven't seen any of these clear-cut footprints with the so-called toes.
You know, the really classic case of a footprint was when Eric Shipton photographed this one over in the Menlung Valley, which was just across the hill from us. And my feeling is, and knowing Eric Shipton very well, I have a very strong feeling that he tidied up that track a little bit and made it look just a little bit more spectacular than it probably was before.
I am convinced there's a creature there, and I've compared the tracks that I've seen with bear tracks, which I've also photographed, and it's quite a different imprint. You could see the thumb-like protuberance or whatever. It was a lozenge-shaped track. The fantastic thing was the size. I mean, it wasn't as though it had been expanded by the sun, because it had gone right through the crust and the edges were quite firm.
My footprint was maybe a length of 32, 35 centimeters, quite a big one. Had nails in front, like a bear, but a bear has only a footprint like this. Shipton's footprint has no nails, and my one has nails because this is in the mud, you see it much clearer. And the Tibetans and the Sherpas also say that he has big nails, and I was following the footprints for 3 kilometers.
When you saw it for that first time, can you describe what it looked like?
It was bigger than a man in my vision, but I was on a distance of 10 meters, so it was my impression, it's bigger than me. It was quite hairy and strong, with short legs. And the face was a little bit more white or clear than the body. The body was quite dark. Dark brown, black hairs, long, long hairs. And he has quite a lot of hairs on the head.
Messner's description is supported by many other accounts. Collating all the available information, we create a photo fit of the Yeti. It would almost certainly be a primate, perhaps an unclassified species of mountain orangutan or langur. But it could be some form of ape-man evolved from one of our distant common ancestors. If so, is it a missing link in our own evolution? Many eyewitnesses speak of certain hominid characteristics. We take 4 likely candidates as our models. Australopithecus, Neanderthal man, Homo erectus, and Gigantopithecus. We isolate their principal features. The orangutan is probably the closest known animal to the Yeti. Using it as our base model, we begin to create the photo fit. A prominent brow has been sighted in almost all of the accounts. Next, we choose the eyes. A Chinese witness said it resembled a museum model of Homo erectus. But others talk of the human quality to his eyes. There is a theory that the Yeti is a relic of Neanderthal man who sought refuge in the Himalayas some 40,000 years ago. But Neanderthals had fire and tools. So far, no trace of either has been found in the Himalayas. Descriptions of the Yeti's height suggest Gigantopithecus, a gorilla-sized hominid that, according to fossil evidence, existed in South Asia. But his lips and jaw seem too ape-like, and 5 million years is a long time to be caught in an evolutionary time warp. A man-sized hominid, Australopithecus, who had neither fire nor tools, was around in significant numbers 1 million years ago. It is just conceivable that pockets of the species have evolved and survived in the remote Himalayas in China and the Soviet Union, even in the Canadian wastes. His prehensile lips fit most descriptions, and his defined nostrils make him a strong contender. Finally, if we give our model the dome-shaped head, muscly chest and neck, and the reddish-brown color that most witnesses speak of, our Yeti could look something like this. The lack of any hard evidence makes it all highly speculative. But if we accept that it does exist, is this the face of the Yeti? There is no convincing photo of a Yeti. This one was taken in 1986, but it's more likely to be a rock or a bush.
I mean, everybody wants the Yeti to exist. And often in the conditions in which they actually make their sightings, they either have been climbing very hard and are panting and puffing, or the conditions are misty, or they see this apparent creature at a considerable distance. And we all know that if you're on a big snow slope and there's even a tiny rock and you watch it, it seems to be moving all over the place. Of course, it's not moving. And it's all, you know, a sense of delusion.
I mean, there's no doubt that if someone thought they saw a Yeti on the summit ridge of Everest, they might be hallucinating, a sort of third person, but not at the altitudes that they have alleged to have been seen, not at the altitudes that I've seen the tracks.
If Don Willans say, on an Annapurna base camp at 4,000 meters, in the night, in the moonlight, he have seen a creature going through the woods, It's surely true, because he has not hallucinations there. And I personally, having this experience in Tibet, I had not hallucinations on 4,000 meters. And especially after seeing this creature, I have seen and photographed and touched the footprints in the mud.
Early on, the climbing was very strenuous in deep, soft snow. I think in a small way, we'd underestimated the challenge of Manlunse. The sun was very hot at midday. Couldn't take off enough of your clothes to stay cool. The packs were really heavier than I'd expected them to be. The higher we got, the more brittle the ice became, and it slowed down our progress considerably. I think we all began to realize that we might be going a bit too slow to make the summit. Well, on the afternoon of the fourth day, the clouds coming over the border from Nepal looked particularly menacing, and we decided to stop and build a snow cave. Should it storm, we'd have a place to retreat to. The weather appeared to be a bit unstable, but more importantly, we were very low on food and fuel. It's a tough decision to be so near the top and feeling fairly fit and confident and at the same time make a decision to go back down. We had about 5,000 feet of descending to get back to the base camp. I think it was especially difficult for Chris to have to go back down. He'd been very high on Manlunse the year before. This was the second time there, and he was certain he wouldn't come back to the mountain again.
It was almost nostalgic because I could just see Annapurna II, which was the mountain I climbed fully 28 years ago on the far horizon.
At base camp, journalist Ian Walker files a different story. Strange things have been going on. Charlie Clark has discovered two blue sheepskins neatly cut from the flesh. He doesn't know what to make of them. Is it the work of a snow leopard, or has a Yeti been around? The controversy as ever makes the headlines, but nothing is resolved.
In 1961, we did a pretty thorough search of the whole project up in the Himalayas, and we examined all the evidence, and we examined tracks, and we talked to people, and so on. And we came to the conclusion that the Yeti was essentially a mythological creature.
I am thinking there are maybe 100 Yetis left. Maybe in 100 years we have more, maybe we have left, maybe they are totally extincted. And if you make this comparison, so they needed years and years to take one or two pictures of the snow leopard. It will be quite impossible to make a picture of the Yeti.
We leave Men Long Tse, not the first to fail in the search for the Yeti. Half a century ago, the explorer Tillman wrote about his own tantalizing encounter. When the dust of conflict had settled, the abominable snowman survived to pursue his evasive, mysterious, terrifying existence, unruffled by the snow he treads, unmoved as the mountains in which he dwells, uncaught, unspecified, but not unhonored.
Brothers travel to remote Pacific Islands on an encore of the four-part Ring of Fire, beginning next Monday night at 8 on Adventure. But now stay tuned for a comprehensive look at Mideast friction on Arab and Jew, Wounded Spirits in a Promised Land, next on WMHT Channel 17.
Enjoying all this rare and unique content, please show your support by subscribing and leaving comments.